BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
And gentlemen, and welcome to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and tonight I have two topics to tell you about what's going on in the area as far as theater, and actually a little divergent path from it for the second part, and I will lead you into that a little bit later. But starting off, I'm very happy to have back on the program, Matt Fotis from Albright College. Welcome back.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me again. It's good to see you.
Likewise, thank you, and I appreciate that. Now, Matt does a lot of work with theater up there, besides teaching and directing. He's also written a number of things. So, but this time he's going to throw the ball into the students' court and all. And so, I understand you're going to be doing The Big House?
Yeah, so it's our first production of the year at Albright. It's called The Big House. And it's a complete, so it 4 weeks ago, when the first day of school, we had absolutely nothing other than the title. And over the last couple of weeks, the students have been generating all the material. So we've got original music in the show, we've got original writing in the show, and some movement pieces, so it's all been student generated. And I've just sort of been helping put places and puzzle pieces in the right places and helping spur on ideas, but it's really, really been driven by the students, so it's been a lot of fun to work on.
Now, in the past, you've done somewhere what it was thought of, created, and done in like a couple of days or something like that? Have you, am I?
Yeah, we've done some 24 hour theater festivals. We've done some 96 hour ones, which sort of lets you go to sleep in between. And then, so this is my 11th year at Albright. So this is the 11th straight year that we've had an original work on our main stage. And we've had many more before that, with myself and Jeff Lentz, of course, who's just a brilliant theater artist. And we've had original works of all kinds. So we've done your traditional play that we've written. Jeff and Cocole Bernal have done silent operas. We've done sketch comedy. We've done short plays. And so this is kind of falling into what is known as devised theater. In that, we sort of start with this idea of home, which is kind of our guiding principle, and then we all just sort of create it together. So it's an exciting process for this one, but just sort of an exciting department of sort of generating new work all the time. And so it's exciting to be at the department and helping students get that bug and go out there and create. You're going to talk to one of our students a little bit later, who's creating in the film world. So it's exciting. Yeah. I think I've said the word exciting 12 times now. So.
Oh, okay. Well, I won't count, and we won't worry about
use
that.
Use my quota. So.
But okay. So when you brought them in into this. What kind of background did the student have? Did they have a fairly decent background in theater at that point, or did they have to almost start from the beginning with that?
Yeah, so we've got the full range here. So we've got theater majors, you know, senior full theater majors, and then we have folks who this will be their first time they've ever been on stage. And one of the things that we did different with this show is the audition process was sort of flipped. So rather than me saying, the idea is about exploring community and what it means to be home. Mm-hmm. So rather than me being like, well, you're not good enough to give your ideas to be in the show, we sort of flipped mm-hmm. it. And so the audition process was 2 days of kind of laying out some of the games we'd be playing, doing some of the exercises that we'd be doing mm-hmm. in rehearsal, mm-hmm. And really putting it in the students' court and saying, is this something you want to be involved with? We laid out, here's the whole rehearsal schedule, here's how everything's going to go, how it's going to look. So come try us on. And so rather than me selecting, the mm-hmm. 10 students I wanted to mm-hmm. to be in the show, like you would, for Tartuffe, our next show, mm-hmm. This was, if you are interested, you like this, this 48-hour sort of try-on, mm-hmm. and you want to commit to it, you're in the show. And so we've got students then that this is the first time they've ever done anything. And then, like I said, we've got some of our Albright all-stars mm-hmm. As well. But it's really, they've really been sort of seamlessly mixed. Sometimes you have to be like, let's face the audience. But, mm-hmm. For the most part, it's been great to have people in the room who... have never been in a theater before because they're bringing in new ideas mm-hmm. and having us sort of, it's easy to fall in. Well, this is how we've always done it. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, why are you doing it that way? Like, mm-hmm. I don't know. That's a good question. Let's let's think about it. So it's been fun to have some new people who, might never be in a show again, but this is sort of mm-hmm. their one time, or, some people who are going to get bit by the bug and mm-hmm. we'll see them again and again. Mm-hmm. I don't know what your original question was, so I kind of took that a lot away.
A little bit about getting started with it, the students and all that. Now, have the students really had an interest in this and coming out with these? Are they like hesitant? I would presume it's probably a whole range.
Yeah, I mean, most of the folks who showed up were, we weren't sort mm-hmm. of pulling people off the street.
Right.
and so those, first 2 weeks of rehearsal, and it's, we started, August 29th or 30th or whatever that mm-hmm. Monday was. So, we're really just sort of about building community within the ensembles, playing mm-hmm. a lot of games. Mm-hmm. We had them sort of do brainstorming sessions and sort of writing mm-hmm. out, mm-hmm. what does community mean to you on post-it notes? And then we've sort of taken those ideas and kind of then structured mm-hmm. those out into mm-hmm. Some pieces. And we've had folks sort of working in teams on some stuff, some folks working individually as sort of big collectives. So we kind of been trying to get everybody kind of to mix and match, and because mm-hmm. part of it's about community. So, well, mm-hmm. you've never talked to a biology student before, or you've never, you've mm-hmm. never, what's it like in Maryland? What's mm-hmm. it, so mm-hmm. it's been a lot of, my experience in finding housing is different than your experience mm-hmm. in finding housing, and mm-hmm. What's it like renting in a city versus renting in a more rural area. So there's been a lot of stuff sort of internally that's been really great sort of discussions that we've been having mm-hmm. about, what some of these housing issues that, we're all facing mm-hmm. as everybody's rents get jacked mm-hmm. up, and homes are getting bought up by mm-hmm. corporations to mm-hmm. then rent to people for more, or even more money. So it's been a lot of sort mm-hmm. of really generative, conversations, and then we sort of, midway through, was like, well, now how can we take all this sort of ideas that we've been talking about and exploring and turn those into theatrical pieces. And that's where we're at right now. And we're sort of putting it together for opening next week.
Well, speaking of which, when is it going to be done?
Yeah, so it is, and you have it in front of me, your view, so if I say the round date. So it's Thursday, September 29th is opening night, and then at 8 o'clock, so it'll be Thursday the 29th, Friday the 30th, and Saturday, October 1st, are all at 8 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And then there'll be a Sunday matinee at 2 o'clock on the 2nd of October. The opening night, we usually do have a sort of community talk back afterwards, so it's always nice to have folks there to sort of respond to the piece, to you know, share their thoughts on home and community. After the Friday night show, there's always an improv show, so that's always a fun sort of event that kind of is a, usually it sort of uses the show and those themes as kind of inspiration for some improvised comedy. And then our Sunday show is part is kicking off Albright's Empowering Albright Voices Week. And so we have sort of a whole slew of events throughout the week that are about sort of empowering Albright voices. And so that we sort of kick everything off. And then there'll be events on Thursday and Friday throughout the day, which would be the 6th and 7th, I think, of October.
Now, the Albright Voices, what is that kind of, is that like singing, or is that kind of like ideas?
It's everything. It's everything. So there's some stuff that's, you know, performance-based, and but there's lectures, there's workshops, there's cooking demonstrations. So there's all sorts of things about sort of exploring the community and all the different voices in it, and allowing people who, you know, historically haven't had a voice to have a voice and a seat at the table. And so since this show is really created by the students and sort of celebrating what they have to say, we're kind of setting the table for the rest of the events for the week.
What were some of the ideas that came up from the students for this? And have you, you've committed to a given topic at this point, a subject or whatever?
Yeah, so the it's sort of like a mixture of a variety show and a sort of sketch comedy show and a movement piece, so sort of all mixed together. And the big theme is, you know, we all say home, and what does that really mean, right? So we sort of broke it into three big categories. So we sort of have the idea of home as a place. Home is people, and then home is sort of an idea. And so we've generated a bunch of stuff out of that. So for instance, one of the students wrote a piece that's all the other planets sort of having an intervention with Earth about, you know, what to do with the humans who are destroying the planet, which is, it's a funny piece.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's crushingly sad, but it's funny. There's a, you know, a piece about sort of the different ways families can support and not support us as we're sort of leaving home. As we're going through, we've got a piece about sort of technology and the way, you know, everybody has, well, most people have in their phone, they have a number that's saved as home, right? So it's sort of exploring, well, who are you calling when you say home? You know, and who's picking up on the other end is one of the pieces. And we've got a couple original songs that some of the students who are involved with Vine Records, which is the sort of label that we have through the Music Industry Studies Program. So they're going to be performing a couple of songs that are about finding community, as well as, so one of them is sort of about, you know, people coming together. And one of the songs is about finding strength, and sometimes we need to leave some people behind us. And that can sort of, you know, make us stronger. And there's all sorts of pieces. I'm blanking on everything that's in the show. You know, there's a little bit of Wizard of Oz parody. you know, with the red slippers and whatnot. And so, yeah, there's a whole bunch of different pieces. There's a, you know, a dating game show about picking your residence hall on campus. So there's some sort of Albright specific things, some sort of things that are specific to, you know, being 20 years old, growing up in the world that's sort of exploding around you. And then there's some more like, so, you know, big universal things about, you know, how we create home with the people around us.
Yeah, I would imagine it would expand to, you know, the whole of the globe as your home, because what are you going to do? Are you going to protect it? You're going to, you know, get along with people if possible.
Yeah.
Now, this is, I'm sure, is an interesting and good opportunity for the student to break out maybe of their shell or anything, develop more confidence in themselves?
Oh, yeah. So one of the things we've been doing in rehearsal is every rehearsal they have to say something that they like about what they're doing or about themselves, because they always will pre-apologize. So we're trying to work on that. But the real idea is that, you know, this is a chance for you to cast yourself in a piece. You know, so it is, it's not, I need someone to play Tartuffe for November. You know, this is a chance for you to cast yourself, to give yourself a voice, to really sort of imagine the kind of roles and pieces that you want to be in, the kind of thing, you know, what do you want to use the stage to say? And so this is really meant to be that kind of opportunity, you know, because sometimes the theater can be, and entertainment can be limiting, and, you know, well, you're a tall, awkward, suburban dad, so that's the role you're going to play. You know, and you walk into the casting room and everybody looks exactly like you. So this is a chance to, you know, cast yourself in a way that maybe other people haven't seen you before. And certainly is a way to sort of build confidence in your voice and what you have to say, and that being worth, right, people hearing it.
Yeah, I can see could be a good way to, in a sense, maybe get something off your mind, off your chest, about how things are going, you know, within the home setting or in general, as well as, you know, what I like about it or this and all, and the interaction maybe between family members or family and friends.
Yeah, and it's been a good way for people to sort of discover some of the skills that they maybe didn't know they had or to refine some. So, you know, some people at the beginning were like, oh, I'm not a writer, and but then, well, that's okay. But you come up with amazing ideas, and we have people who can, you know, put that into script form, but, right? So let's not say, oh, I can't do this. But, like, you have amazing ideas, right? That was, you know, you brought this great idea to us, and then we can, you know, we have other people who can help package it. So, you know, think helping students to sort of expand their notions of what, you know, creating in the theater really means, both on the stage as well as, you know, behind the scenes and, you know, in the lighting and costuming, and like, oh, wait, I could do that? I didn't realize that was something that, you know, I'm amazing at or I have a real interest in. So in a lot of ways, this show is, you know, about sort of discovery of, like, here are all the things that you can do and options that are available to you.
Yeah. And I guess have others look at you in a new light because, oh, I didn't know you could do that. You can do that? Wow. Yeah. You know,
exactly.
That's a good way to build self-respect, confidence, and that. And I know you do that in other aspects of your work in theater over at Albright, because you have the improv aspect of it, and you have an improv troupe there, and you do a festival of with improv. And I think that's coming up in February.
Yeah, it's the 11th 11th mm-hmm. Albright Improv Festival. I think mm-hmm. it's February 4th. It's the first Saturday of February.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we have a big ensemble on campus that's sort of under the umbrella of Albright Improv. And within mm-hmm. that, we have two groups. We have one that's sort of open to anybody that wants to come play. Mm-hmm. And then we have an audition-based group. Mm-hmm. That's like our little league traveling team. Mm-hmm. They go to tournaments and stuff, mm-hmm. but they both perform on campus. They're both open to everybody. A lot of people sort of made their way from improv into this show. Mm-hmm. And our president of improv was just named Homecoming King, right?
So that's all right.
So way to go, Paul. And that's another sort of area where we get a lot of folks from around campus. So I mean, it's mm-hmm. I think we have less theater majors in improv than some science majors and things. So we've got mm-hmm. folks from all over campus. And that's really great, to sort of celebrate that, because that's, one of the things Albright's really about is mm-hmm. crossing disciplines and making mm-hmm. connections across mm-hmm. areas. And so the improv groups are really, manifestation of that. We've got sort of students from all over within it. And it's just a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. The audition-based team rehearses throughout the day, throughout the week, but the open one is Friday afternoon, so it's a really great sort of fun way to end the week for everybody. Mm-hmm. Get together and play some games and have some fun. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then we have the festival, and you've mm-hmm. been at it a couple times.
Oh, yeah.
You've graced our stage, so that's always a pleasure.
Thank you.
Hope you'll be there again.
I'm looking forward to it. I've missed it with all the craziness of the past couple of years and all getting back to it, because I find that it's, for me, it's reinvigorating and it helps me hone different skills. I find that watching other students in there, some that may not have that confidence in being in front of people, and this goes especially for other disciplines where they'll eventually have to be in front of people giving a speech, a proposal, or what have you. And even just in general conversation, how do you feel more comfortable just talking to another person you've never met?
Yeah, no, improv is a great place for introverts. It seems mm-hmm. it seems counterintuitive, but mm-hmm. Most people in the club are introverted, and so it's mm-hmm. like we all get together and mm-hmm. we're introverts together, and we work on being better with the extroverts who mm-hmm. attack us all day. Mm-hmm. It's good. And mm-hmm. then Lady Strongman over at the Goggle Works is putting together a new show called Scriptprov that I'm in and my wife Jeanette are in involved with, and some folks from Reading Theater and Genesius and Reading mm-hmm. Civic. And that's a really fun new format that we got a show October 13th coming up. And so how that works is there's a scripted scene that two actors prepare. Mm-hmm. The improvisers are not in the room. Mm-hmm. They do the scene. One of the scripted actors stays, one of them leaves, and they're replaced by an improvised actor. The scripted actor, they get to, mm-hmm. they have their script, they go through the script with the improv actor, mm-hmm. and we see what happens, and it's mm-hmm. sort of a nice, sort of fun experiment of mm-hmm. kind of smashing some different genres of theater together. And so we did a test show and a couple of runs over the summer, and we're pretty excited to unveil that here in a couple of weeks as mm-hmm. well. So a lot of improv and sort of mm-hmm. creation happening in Reading, and mm-hmm. excited to be a little bit of a part of that.
Well, great. I hope I can get out to catch it.
Yeah, so we're at the Goggle Works. It's at the Goggle Works.
Okay.
So plenty of parking.
Yeah, plenty of parking. That's one of the nice things about there and a couple other places where theater is being produced is that you do have the ease and parking and all that.
Yeah, what are the helps. Three questions are, what's the play about, how long is it, and where can I park?
Mm-hmm. That's sometimes a fourth one. How much does it cost?
Yeah.
But, I think, hopefully part of this program helps to other people understand what really goes into these productions so that they can understand the cost that they the price that they pay for their ticket and all, and knowing that, oh wow, if I go to New York, oh, their materials are more expensive and blah blah.
Sure, sure, yeah.
Yeah. So, what are you looking forward to the most for the remain for the school year, with either the shows you'll be doing and all, or anything that you're personally working on for?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm kind of
New Britain.
Yeah, I'm kind of front loaded here, so you know, obviously. Real excited about the next 2 weeks here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sort of putting this show up and whatnot. But I think we got a really exciting season mm-hmm. lined up. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got Tartuffe coming up in mm-hmm. November, and then we're doing Orlando in mm-hmm. February, and we've got Andrea Hart coming in to guest direct that. Mm-hmm. She does a lot of work with Yoakum.
Mm-hmm.
And then Jeff is doing Spring Awakening at the mm-hmm. end of the mm-hmm. year, and you know, everything Jeff does is amazing, so of course,
oh, yes.
looking, you know, excited mm-hmm. about that, and Spring Awakening's a, mm-hmm. you know, great piece.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm always excited to see what the students are creating all year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's sort of a, you know, what are the seniors going to leave behind? What mm-hmm. are the first years going to sort of start establishing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've got some really strong students at on mm-hmm. campus right now, who are doing a lot of stuff both with us and in the community as well. You know, so we have a couple of students who are just who are in Amadeus over at EPAC, and
mm-hmm.
So we're really excited about that for them. So I'm just excited to see all the creation mm-hmm. that's happening on campus,
mm-hmm.
And throughout. It feels like we're at a really good moment in Reading sort of performance.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of sort of stuff that's sort of regenerating here as we make our way into year three of the pandemic.
yeah.
But it feels like it's a really sort of generative time, mm-hmm. and so I'm just excited to be a part of that.
Well, break a leg with it. I look forward to getting out there and seeing it. I hope that works out. I'm getting involved in some things myself, the schedule is changing, but you
sure.
know,
we've got a couple of new faculty members, so we're excited.
Great.
Got a new lighting designer, Jen
mm-hmm.
Rock, and
right.
a new costume designer who's an alum of the mm-hmm. program, Liz Polly. And so they're bringing all sorts of new and exciting things, along with, you know, brilliant artistic work, but thinking
mm-hmm.
about new ways that we can develop the, mm-hmm. the program and the curriculum. And
mm-hmm.
So we're just, it's an exciting sort of transitional time.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm.
Looking forward to all the stuff we're going to do.
Okay, last but not least, where again is your show? The show, The Big House, being done, and the dates?
Yeah,
and
so The Big House is at Albright Theater, which
mm-hmm.
is on it's like 1600 13th Street.
Yeah,
right across from the football stadium.
Mm-hmm.
Thursday, September 29th. Is opening night at 8 p.m. So we're Thursday the 29th, Friday the 30th, and Saturday, October 1st at 8 p.m., Sunday, October 2nd at 2 p.m. At the Albright Theater.
Okay, well, we're going to go to a break, but again, break a leg with the show, and I look forward to the improv festival later on, and I'm sure the kids involved in everything in this show will really shine.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks for having me, and thanks for everything you do for the arts and the community. So.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And now we're going to go and take a little break here and reset, because I have a few people coming in, and we'll be back. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and you're watching Backstage on Berks Community Television. We'll be right back.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome back. I'm David Edgar Guest, and you're watching Backstage here on Berks Community Television. We just finished a segment with Matt Fotis from Albright College and their student-generated show coming up, The Big House. And now, just to give a quick mention of a couple other things. There are so many things going on in this immediate area, as well as within a short drive from here, from the Lehigh Valley down to out east in Lancaster, not Lancaster, Pottstown and Skipack, Pennsylvania. There are a lot of different theater groups out there, Playcrafters, of course, you've heard me mention from Skipack. And just in town, coming up very soon, October the 21st through October the 23rd, two evening performances and a matinee of Watch on the Rhine, Lillian Hellman's wonderful, wonderful power and powerful drama about what some of the events that led up to the Second World War and dealing with the subject of fascism and all that. So it's going to be a fascinating and powerful production directed by John Ganser. And I hope you get out to see that. There are other things going on with it. They have a piano concert, and they have they also have an art exhibit. Robert Pepper, one of our local artists, is doing that, and they have silver, wood, and ivory, flute and piano, and recorder concert. So there's a lot of things going on here, and I'm just barely touching the top of it. So please get out there, check the different websites for the theaters and all, and hopefully we'll be able to get more information out to you. But now there's an exciting event coming up very shortly, and we'll find out a little bit more exactly what that's about, but it's the Reading Film Fest. And one of the young men that's doing the show, Bence Veres, is with me tonight to talk about his play, his film. He wrote it, he's directing it, he's acting in it, he's doing a lot of different things. And I've seen him in some of the live stage productions in the past, so he's really making an interesting transition here. So, Bence, welcome to Backstage.
Oh, thank you for having us. We really appreciate it.
You're certainly welcome. And if you'll help me out with this, Charles? Is it Charles?
Yeah, he's Charles.
Okay. And Chris?
Christian, yes.
Chris, okay. And what your last names again?
Valera.
Valera.
Putt.
Pet. Okay. Sorry, this is not gray hair. It's my brain's falling out. So, every once in a while. Anyway, these are three of the people involved in this film. And Bence, it's your baby, so to speak. Tell us how you got started with the idea, and what made you kind of make the transition from stage to film?
Right. So basically, back in November of last year, I was just finishing up my first semester at Temple University, and I had realized that I didn't really have a lot of projects to show in my portfolio. I had a lot of student pieces, but not necessarily anything that I could show and say this is something that I made that I'm proud mm-hmm. of. So my father and I, who is a close collaborator of mine, his name is Jula Veresh, and he and I decided that we should make a film that's both original and affordable, and something that can be shot locally here mm-hmm. as well. So mm-hmm. in December of last year, we started putting together the script, and the title of the film is The Idiot's Guide to Swindling an Amateur Filmmaking. And in December of last year, I had started an internship at a local film studio here in Reading. It's called Reading Film Studios, and mm-hmm. it's run by Antonio Moore and Camille Charles, and shout out to the two of them. Wouldn't be here without you. Mm-hmm. But without their help, that film wouldn't necessarily be possible. So through my services and help at the studio, Antonio Moore and Camille Charles essentially gave me all of the resources that the studio had to my disposal. All the manpower, the crew, the equipment, and the on-site locations. And that's pretty much how we got the ball rolling with the film.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now tell us a little bit about the film. I understand that it's there is some language and all in that, mm-hmm. so it's that's one of the reasons I can't show anything. We have to watch the different codes on TV yet. Tell us a little bit about the film itself.
Right. So the film follows the story of these three young amateur filmmakers by the name of Barry, who I play, and Igor and Butterscotch. And they live out of their van, they're homeless, but they have this very big dream of becoming Hollywood bigwigs, very famous Hollywood directors and filmmakers. Mm-hmm. And so they decide for their next endeavor to become famous that they're going to make a short film about a jewelry store robbery. And so there's, at the same time, there's an alternate story happening where these two show up. They play brothers by the names of Larry and Terry, and they are also these two-bit criminals, these grifters who run petty crimes in the city. And so they too, like mm-hmm. the filmmakers, want to be famous, just not in the same way. They mm-hmm. they watch the film Goodfellas, and they mm-hmm. very much admire the characters that Robert De Niro and Joe Pesci play in mm-hmm. that film. So they decide that their attempt to become big time gangsters, that they're going to rob the local marijuana dispensary. and so while this is happening, the three filmmakers, their actors drop out of production last minute. So they're mm-hmm. left scrambling looking for actors. And while the robbery is happening, the two brothers, they make their escape, and the two crews, they cross paths, and the robbers become the actors in the film, and it's sort of a meta-commentary on filmmaking and film itself.
Well, I had the opportunity to watch it, and I enjoyed it a lot. I laughed. It was quite funny.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And you could see some of the shots of various places in Reading that you would recognize and all, and that was quite enjoyable.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And you're playing the director of the film.
Yes.
In there, as well as actually doing that.
Yeah.
Why did you decide to do something like this with the director and that sort of thing as part of the film that you're entering and directing?
Well, I personally, recently at least, I've been seeing like a void in film. There's a lot of superhero films, a lot of horror films, a lot of mm-hmm. genre films that don't really necessarily have a lot of heart. And what I was also noticing is that there's not a lot of films about the very people that make them possible, filmmakers mm-hmm. themselves. Mm-hmm. So that's this kind of void I was trying to fill. And that's the audience for this film, that when they're mm-hmm. watching it, the filmmakers who are watching it will really appreciate the themes and the story because it's really about them. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I was wanted to make a story about filmmaking itself, because I was mm-hmm. seeing not too many stories about it. I mean, there's mm-hmm. a famous one that we kind of look to when we were making mm-hmm. this film is Living in Oblivion, but mm-hmm. other than that, there isn't too many films about filmmaking, so that was the main intention behind it.
Okay. Chris, tell us a little bit about your character in the show and how you got involved with films and acting in films.
So I played his little brother, Terry. He's a bit more of a naive optimist in a way. And whatever he says, I just go along with it. I'm just like, my brother knows best. I'm going to follow his lead. But for me personally, I've been fascinated with film since I was 12. Always wanted to do filmmaking in general, and it wasn't until somewhat recently that I started to take it a little bit more seriously. Mm-hmm. And I heard about there being a film studio on the south side of Reading, and that's when I got to meet Bence and a lot of the crew members over there, and that's when they told me, hey, we're making a film. He goes, I feel like you could really be a good part of this movie. I need you to play this guy named Terry. And I was like, okay, yeah, I'll give it a shot. I can give that a shot.
Okay. Okay. How about you, Charles?
Exactly what he said.
Okay, very good. It's the same. That doesn't work on TV.
Yeah. But yeah, actually, I was at a meet and greet for dog sitting, and it just so happened to be Bence's parents. And we just got, you know, we were just talking, chit-chatting, and one thing led to another, and they mentioned their son was shooting a film and that he was looking for actors. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned that I was an actor, and one thing led to another, and ended up auditioning. Originally auditioned for a different role, but Bence was very persistent and encouraging to go for the role of Larry instead. Mm-hmm. He said he could picture me in as that character better, and yes, and that's. That's the backstory of it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Had either of you done any stage acting before, or have you basically always acted in a film or type of environment?
I've done primarily recorded film stuff, but I did do a play, and I did do some production assistance on a show as well. But primarily film.
Okay.
Also primarily film, did some stage work, lots of PA work behind the camera.
Yeah.
But yeah, a little bit of, you know, a little bit of everything.
Yeah. Okay, good. That's good. Having a full understanding of everything that goes into producing a film is very valuable.
Right.
What I consider very valuable on stage, in a stage production, you know. So, what do you find is the difference between acting on a stage in a live play here, or acting in a film? Is there any difference, or and if so, what?
You want to take?
Have
this?
Ever thought I mean, of it?
You can go if you got something.
I think when it comes to film, there's a big focus on the physiognomy of a character, such as the facial expressions, whereas on stage you have more of more volume, more intonation. It's more in like large movements rather than the subtleties that you have in film, like more control in film and then more outward expression on stage.
Have you, either of you, found it very difficult to translate from one film to the other, or was that?
It was definitely difficult. When I did my first play ever, the amount of dialogue to remember plus movements and blocking and stuff like that was dramatically different, because this was, it's like a long one take, and you have to make sure you hit it every single time you do a show.
Mm-hmm.
And that was like, I can't stop to take a second take or a third take. I gotta make sure I know it perfect by like by memory, yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely stressful,
to say the least. Yeah.
How many takes do you usually do a little segment of the scene or the scene done? And this is just a ballpark average or whatever.
I think what we did ahead of time actually was that we rehearsed quite a bit so that all the marks can be hit. Mm-hmm. And so that when we actually got to set, everybody knew what they were doing and there wasn't a lot of time wasted. We made sure that everything went as efficiently as possible. So most things probably took about 3 or 4 takes, and we would just do extras as well just to be sure we had content to work with. But there were some that took maybe like 8 to 10.
So. There was the one physically enduring scene. It's a scene where we're running and tumbling, and it involved a lot of physicality, and that scene, at least, I think there was at least 6.
Was it the running under the trunks?
Yeah.
Okay, I was going to say.
No spoilers.
No spoilers. It's something to look forward to.
Yeah.
But definitely that one. A little bit more specific to the character of Terry was one, was with the with the bus, hey, you guys want to be in the film?
Oh, yeah, with the van.
There was a moment where we were kind of had to show that we were both like tired from running. Mm-hmm. And specifically, Terry has an inhaler, so I had to really give that. Mm-hmm. And we did a decent amount to the point where I started getting lightheaded from all the over and over.
Yep. I can imagine.
I suffered for the craft, but.
Yeah.
And that, your sacrifice is greatly appreciated.
Yeah, he's very methodical. He's a genius.
Now, remembering the little running scene that you had, how long did you have in between takes, and how difficult was it to get reset? Because I had the pleasure and opportunity to be in a film years and years ago. I don't think it ever saw the light of day, but it was A Ballad of Susanna Cox, and I had the folks on my program to talk about it, and then I went to be an extra on it, and it was just amazing. But I heard a few people go, is this going to take so long? I had other plans for today, and that sort of thing, so that's, it's time consuming, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure.
And how did it go for you to reset yourself for each?
Well, when it came to lunch, I'm a bit of a diva. Mm-hmm. So that's the only time. I would say that was the longest break we had. Uh-huh. But between takes, it was good pacing. Mm-hmm. I think that's everyone can contribute to that as mm-hmm. far as like the cast, crew, yeah. the director himself, of course, overseeing everything and making sure everyone was physically and mentally prepared for mm-hmm. the next scene.
Yeah. I feel like the only biggest, like, longest reset took us was when we got visited by Thor the dog.
Yeah.
There was this massive, white, husky-looking kind of dog that was just adorable.
It's a great period.
It just came onto the set, and we were just like, let's take 20, and just like...
That probably was the longest break that we had. Yeah.
Okay, and for you, Bence, tell us what it was like for you to, do this show, this film, and the different, the time it takes and all you're preparing for it.
Well, it was a very long time, and it did take a long time after shooting it, of course, because you have the different steps of production. You have pre-production, production where you're actually shooting the film, mm-hmm. and then post-production. Mm-hmm. So the total was about like a 6-month process. So mm-hmm. 2 months mm-hmm. was spent yeah. doing pre-production, and I was doing a lot of the pre-production planning myself. Mm-hmm. So production schedule, shot list, mm-hmm. Doing the auditions, doing rehearsals, pretty much everything that is handled within pre-production mm-hmm. I was doing myself. And then mm-hmm. the actual production happened, and that was, I think, probably the most enjoyable part of it, because mm-hmm. that was the most efficient part mm-hmm. as well. And that's where you're really seeing everything that you're doing, all the work that you're putting in, finally coming mm-hmm. to life. And then finally sitting down, looking over the footage, and then editing it together, that takes a decent amount of time as well. I think mm-hmm. I was editing for maybe 2 or 3 months. So
okay.
it's, yeah, filmmaking is very mm-hmm. long. It's a very arduous process. Mm-hmm. It can be quite painstaking, especially if you're trying to get all the details just right. But mm-hmm. seeing the final product and watching it completed mm-hmm. is the best feeling in the world. Mm-hmm.
I can imagine, you do get to see the work you do as opposed to an actor on the stage and all that, unless it's recorded for their history of the theater or whatever. You don't really get a chance to see what's going on and how it comes, it's okay, did it feel right and all that, mm-hmm. that sort of thing. So quickly, as we start coming down to the end of the program, what was it, how much did you enjoy doing this and working together and putting things, or is this a good group?
All of it.
Yeah.
You notice I put them on the spot.
you'll never work with me again.
But no, it's very good. Now, you're entering this in the Berks Film Fest?
In the Reading Film Reading Fest, Film yes. It's Film a part Fest. Of the official selection. Mm-hmm. It'll be featured in the Made in Reading category.
Okay.
And the premiere will be October 30th at 1:30 p.m. And mm-hmm. you can catch that at the Reading IMAX RC11.
Okay. Now, in general, is that where all the films are being shown, or are there different locations where the films are being
well,
shown?
Well, there's it's split between the Goggle Works mm-hmm. and the Reading IMAX. So there's certain events and there's certain films being shown mm-hmm. at Goggle Works, but then they're also showing films at the IMAX as mm-hmm. well.
Okay. And how would they find out, how would people find out about where and when all these events, especially yours?
Yeah, you can go to the official Reading Film Fest website. That's www.readingfilmfest.com. And there's ticket information on there, especially for the different days and the different showings. Mm-hmm. My film will not be the only one shown in the Made in Reading category. There'll be three mm-hmm. others as well. Mm-hmm. So there's different blocks and different events that you can go to and view on the Reading Film Fest website.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I think since your film is a little different from theater, I won't say break a leg. I will say break a diode, break a computer chip. No, but
scratch a lens.
Best to you.
What? Like the scratch a lens or something.
Ah, good one. The good one. Can I steal it? Okay. Well. The best. Thank you for being on the program, and I look forward to hearing from
you
folks.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
In the future.
Of course.
Take good care.
Thank you. You too.
And for you folks, thank you for being with us again this month to talk about theater and the arts and acting and film now and all. And I hope you join me next time. For Backstage, I'm your host, David Edgar Guest. We'll see you next time, Backstage. Take care.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.